So, Andy, welcome along.
Well, Paul, it's lovely to be here in
Yeah,
the
and it's
Keysound studios.
it is, yeah.
Marvellous.
Yeah.
Marvellous.
Nice new setting for us.
It's very nice.
Yeah.
Very nice.
I mean, obviously, you've only come a few miles up the
Not
road because you
far.
don't live a million miles from us.
Yes.
But it's still very much appreciated that you've come out on a Sunday for us.
I dashed home from church,
Well,
got
there you
changed.
go.
Here we
There
are.
you go. There you go. Andy, we're here hopefully the next hour or so in your company, and you bought your Korg Pa1000.
Indeed, yes.
The irony is, we go back to mid-80s.
A long time, Paul.
Yeah,
A long, long
mid-80s, I
time.
think, when we our paths first crossed when we were both working for Yamaha.
Indeed, yes, indeed.
And
I
in
think
those.
I joined in 1987,
All
and I think
right, okay.
you were already there then
That's
at
right,
that point. Yeah,
yeah. So late 80s.
yes.
And in those days, we were both heavily into the electronic organ, weren't we?
Well,
That was our instrument.
indeed, that's what I first learned to play. Oh, sorry
Yep,
about that.
that's all right.
That's what I first learned to play.
Yep.
And since then, we've seen all sorts of developments over the past 45 odd years.
I know, I know. And
Grief.
we sort of lost touch for a few years,
Yes,
but for various
various
reasons.
reasons, yep.
And as I say, the irony of it is we've met up again and discovered purely by accident that we both now own Korg keyboards.
Yes. Which
So,
is remarkable, really, isn't
yeah,
it?
but
It's really
how did
remarkable.
you make the switch?
Well, after Yamaha, I joined Casio,
Yeah.
headed up their music division for 6 or 7 years, and my wife actually had an opportunity to, believe it or not, work in America.
Okay.
So we actually moved over to America in 2016. And at that point, I was very kindly loaned by Korg America a PA4X.
Okay.
And that was the first time I'd really ever sort of been exposed to Korg, a
Yeah.
range of keyboards.
Yeah.
And I loved it. It's
Yeah.
just a great instrument.
Yeah.
Fantastic sound, fantastic quality. All the studio effects, etc. It's just a great
Yeah.
sound.
Yep.
And when I came back from America in 2019, I got a PA1000.
Right.
Simply because it's so good.
Yeah, and that's when I met up with you again.
Yes.
And we've done quite a bit of work together
Indeed.
in the last few years. But I mean, we both go back to that pedigree of people who they live in working in working men's clubs and things
Oh,
like that, didn't
good
we?
grief. Yes. Halcyon days.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Way back when.
Playing all sorts of instruments.
Playing all sorts of instruments, backing all sorts of the old sight reading.
Yeah,
You
yeah,
remember
yeah.
that?
Yeah.
And I once worked with a one-arm drummer, which was a bit of a unique experience.
I think we'll end the conversation there,
Move on.
I'll work that one out. The reason I'm talking about those old days, in the old days, what we used to do was learn to play.
Yes.
And slowly and a little bit sadly, the technology has now become the main element.
Sort of the dominating
Yeah.
point.
And the playing's become a little bit secondary,
Yes.
Which is a shame because actually that's what the hobby is and that's where all the fun is,
Well,
really.
it's a real shame because really the playing can't be secondary.
No.
Because no matter how good the technology is in here,
Yep.
you've still got to be able to play it.
Yeah.
And in actual fact, just for me, this is an interesting point. We're talking about the old organ days. And on many instruments back in the day, there used to be, you know this, tabs, the buttons marked trumpet, clarinet, etc. And frankly, we thought they were great at the time because it was the cutting edge at the time. But frankly, they weren't very realistic.
No.
And with the advent of digital technology and sampling, which is now the sort of recognized way, in other words, the recording of real instruments, musically, you have to be a bit more accurate on these things than you did on the
Yes.
old organ.
Yeah.
Frankly, you could just press a handful of tabs
Yeah.
and you'd get a warm,
Yeah.
woolly sort of organ
Yeah.
sound. Whereas now, when you put a trumpet on, you've got a real trumpet.
And you've got to play it in the right
And you've
area for the trumpet,
exactly.
and you've got to try and phrase it like a trumpet.
Correct.
Otherwise, there is no point in
Correct.
having that wonderful
And
trumpet
in
sound.
fact, my next little segment is going to be a little bit about how to use some of these.
Yeah, I mean, that's really what I was leading you to say.
Right.
It worked. Because Andy and I recently have got into writing a whole series of books, both music books and teaching books, to try to encourage you to get back into the playing side of things. And we'll probably put a little link up on the video. I know today is all about the Korg, but it sort of ties in as well, because you've done all these play-along backings, these MP3s, so yes, that people can actually play along with the songs. They've all been produced on your PA1000.
On this instrument, yes.
And believe me, some of the sounds that come out of it, and unbelievable. And
yeah.
No, they are. And the beauty is, when you give somebody an original piece of music, it's always too easy for them to say, "Oh, I'm not having a go at that. Don't know how it goes."
Yes.
But there's no excuse now, because you've actually played it how it should go.
Yes.
And you've also played it without the melody in, so yes, they can actually play along with Andy as well.
So that version is quite important. It's called the M1 or minus one version.
Yeah.
And there used to be, I suppose you know this,
yep,
the idea of this was some software that Yamaha produced years ago called Disc Orchestra,
yes, yep,
which was actually more for their piano range.
Yes.
Nobody's ever produced anything for an arranger keyboard
in that
style.
No.
And that's what we have now. We have this, take away the melody, you play the melody while the orchestra, which happens to be me, but plays along with you, basically.
Yeah. Okay, so that's a little bit about PA1000. So what we're going to do with Andy over the next hour is, I think one of the first things we're going to do is have a look at the sequencer.
Okay.
In this, because I know Andy loves the sequencer inside the PA1000, and this is very similar to all the PA products that Korg produce. And it's the onboard sequencer that he actually uses to create these play-along backings. You don't use external recorders, computers. It's all done.
All I
on
have
the
at home
machine.
Is
yeah,
this.
Yeah.
And the sequencer, which is a posh recorder at the end of the day,
The
sequencer is all built in, and it gives me the full sort of recording studio capabilities.
Yep. So fantastic. We'll be sitting, having a quick look at how Andy would put a little multi-track recording together on the sequencer.
Excellent.
And then again, with this teaching theme in mind, we're going to ask Andy to maybe take 20 minutes out and just give you a little lesson on a few little things that hopefully will spark that urge again, really, to get back into the playing and improve the playing level.
Don't just push the buttons, push the notes.
And that's it. So it's lovely to have a chat.
Thank
and
you. It's lovely to be here.
We'll just swap the cameras around and we'll be back in just a couple of seconds with the PA1000 sequencer. So, Andy, we're back with you.
Yes.
Quick change around of the cameras there.
Indeed.
And we talked about you showing us the sequencer.
Yes.
Now, I know you love this sequencer.
I love it.
The modern trend, I think, is to link these instruments to computers or an external recorder. But you prefer to work just on the onboard sequencer.
Well, to be honest, the onboard sequencer gives me everything that I need.
Good.
I don't need lots of other bits of kit. In fact, I've got no other bits of kit at home. All I've got is literally this.
Yeah.
And the sequencer, which, as we were saying a few moments ago, is just a posh recording device.
Yes.
Gives me everything I need.
So what would be nice, could you take us through?
Yes.
Putting together a relatively simple multi-track recording.
Yes.
And I'd like you to cover, first of all, your thought process as to how you actually approach it.
Okay.
And then the actual physical recording bit.
So in the sequencer here, the first thing to say is you've got 16 tracks.
Yeah.
So that means you can actually record, if you want to, 16 tracks on top of each other.
Yeah.
Frankly, it's too many.
Yeah.
It's too much. And also, which takes up some of these tracks, is when we use the accompaniment style, which we're going to use in a moment. So in reality, you've probably got 8 tracks available for melodic building up.
Yeah.
That's more than enough.
Yeah, yeah.
You can go into the accompaniment tracks and change them and do all sorts of things to them if you want to, but there's no real need to do that. The recording system is, there's 2 ways to record. The first one is just a simple record.
Yep.
So I can play an accompaniment style, I can play melody, I can change sounds, and the instrument will remember all of that. It's a simple way.
So that's a what you play is what you get.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly, yes. And then the second way is a multi-track system, which is, frankly, a bit more difficult, but you start with a completely blank page.
Okay.
And you can build instrument layering up and up and up.
Yeah, yeah.
We're going to combine the 2 systems, though, and this is the beauty of what you can do here. We can use both systems, because I want the instrument to do a lot of the work for me.
Yep.
I don't want to bother with a bass line and a drum line. I want the instrument to do that, because the accompaniment styles in here are fabulous.
And let's be honest, they're the hard parts to do, because no matter how much of an accomplished musician you are, we're keyboard players. Then to suddenly think like a drummer and have to program the bass drum, the snare drum, the cymbals, it's hard going.
It's hard going.
And then you've got to swap and think, I'll be a bass player now.
Yep.
And you've got to think like a bass player would. But actually, the styles do it brilliantly to start with.
So. Why do it yourself when it's all there for you? So we're going to just play a little tune here. Now, all I've done is set up the basics of what I need. And if we take a little look at the screen, you can see the style I've got is called Piano Ballad.
Yeah.
It's set at 66 beats per minute, so it's quite a slow piece.
Yeah.
I've also set an introduction into the style. And I'm going to play the style, but I'm also going to play a piano line.
Yeah.
The piano line is only a guide. It's a guide track.
So you'll get rid of that.
I'll get rid of that.
Later.
It's just something that I can make sure I'm in the right place in the tune recording this.
Yeah.
I'm actually doing this.
Because that's a good point, because that's something that's difficult to do. If somebody says, just play the left hand for that tune in isolation, you're having to think about the right hand, and if you're anything like me, you get lost halfway through, you can't remember where you are. So just putting a simple guideline, if you make a mistake, doesn't matter, does
it? Doesn't matter, because it's going to go. It's going to go. Yeah. So if I make a mistake, don't worry about it, it's disappearing.
I never do.
No, I know, I know. There's so many. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to go to the sequencer section, and if you look at the screen now, you can see 8 of those boxes. I've got another 8 if I press track select there. But I'm going to be using this 8. In fact, I'm only going to be using this 1 at the moment, track number 1 for this guide piano line. I'm going to record. Now, here I've got several choices. Multi-track sequencer. Don't want to use that at the moment. I'm going to use the backing sequence. Quick record. If you're not really a keyboard player, more of a technician, you've also got step backing sequence where you can literally load things in by beats and by bars. We're not going to use that at the moment, but backing sequence, a quick record just to get going. So let's press okay, and there's my record screen. Now I'm going to play an F chord, because this is the first chord in the piece, and press start. And what actually happens is we get a little counting. There it is. And here's the introduction. Thank you. So that's just 24 bars of our piece. Now I'm going to stop the record.
So has that recorded all the individual style parts?
Yes.
As different tracks?
Yes.
So if you wanted to remove one part or something later, you could do that.
You can do that. So you can either mute tracks. The other thing you can do, if we take a look at the screen now, is you've got individual volumes.
Yes.
So I could actually rebalance everything that's going on in that accompaniment if I wanted to do that. That's not a problem. The thing I'm going to do, though, now is I'm going to save it.
Okay.
Okay. Because I want to use this track to build upon.
Yeah.
Okay. So all I do is go here, press save song, and save. And I'm going to give it a name. And I'm going to name it A1A. All right, because I've already got an A1 in there.
Right.
So I'm going to call it A1A. No, just because I could call it...
Because you can.
Because I can. I could call it Paul's song, Andy's song, whatever you wanted to call it. You can. It's actually called see it in your eyes. But I haven't got time to pop that in. So I'm going to call it A1A. So let's just go, okay. Okay, there's lots of safety nets here, so I can't wipe it out. It's there. Okay, so now I've got song number A1A. I'm going to record over that piano track, the guide track now. So I'm going to select a different instrument, which I can do from here, and I'm going to use a great saxophone sound from here called, where is it? The Pop Alto Sax, which is a great sound.
Yep.
Now, when I play back, the accompaniment part's going to happen automatically.
Yes.
So that leaves me two hands free. So I've got a hand. So I can add all sorts of slides and things because I've now got a free hand because the accompaniment's playing back. Okay, so let's record. This time we're going to multi-track.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, there we go. Now, I don't know whether you can see here, but I've got a little saxophone in track number one.
And it's armed with the red button for record.
It's armed, ready to go.
Yep.
Okay. So now I'm going to start it.
So the minute you press start, now that piano track is gone.
The piano track is gone.
Yeah.
I'm recording over the top of that. I've got all my accompaniment, and I'm going to get a little four-beat count in. Here's the introduction. So I can now end the recording. I'm going to save it again.
Yes.
So I'm going to save the saxophone.
So you get in the habit, and it is a good habit, save after every single update you've done on the recording.
Just in case.
Yeah.
Just in case. Now, the world is my oyster now. Yeah. I've got all of these other tracks that I can do all sorts of things with.
Okay.
I can use any instrument inside of the instrument.
Can I just ask a silly question?
No,
where would we see the accompaniment parts that have been recorded?
So this is track 1 to 8.
Yep.
I don't know whether you can see right at the bottom there. You've got T01 to T08. So if I go over here now I've got T09 to T16.
Okay.
And those are all
the accompaniment parts. Okay. Yeah.
You can see the type of instrument you've got in there. You can adjust the volumes.
I suppose you could change the instrument.
You can change the instruments if you want to. Yeah. So we've got a piano here, which actually is grand piano.
Yeah.
But if I wanted to make that an electric piano,
yes,
I'd simply select electric piano.
Okay.
And now that will replace the grand piano.
Okay. Thanks for that.
So let's put one more, just one more track on top there, and then we'll play something, just some strings.
Okay.
Okay. Just some strings. So I'm going to record. Multi-track still, yeah, that's absolutely fine. Here we go, and we're going to have the introduction, and I'll play some strings high. Yep.
The beauty of doing it this way, you're going to save it again, aren't you?
I'm going to save it again, yes, because I'm obsessed with saving it.
I know. The beauty of doing it this way is you could have as many goes as you want recording those strings.
Of course.
You won't have lost all the previous
all the
work.
Other stuff. And I mean, I do that lots of times at home. I'll record a string part. No, I'd actually like that differently. Yeah. Or I'll put some piano on top of something else. And, no, that didn't quite work. I'll do it differently.
So if I had one comment there, the problem now is it's not all balanced, is it?
Right. Okay.
The saxophone's too loud. Yep.
And the strings are too soft.
Okay.
So we have now a great feature called overdub.
Okay.
Okay. So I'm going to turn those strings up. They're set at the moment at volume level 76.
Yep.
It goes up to 127 at the most. So I'm going to go into there. Multi-track, but I'm going to change my recording mode from overwrite to overdub.
Okay, so that will add.
So I'm now going to change what I've recorded.
Yes.
I've already recorded the strings at level 76. Yep. It's too quiet.
Yeah.
I want to turn it up. I'm also going to turn the saxophone down a little bit as well. I can do it all in one go if I want to. Yep. So the first thing I'm going to do actually is turn that down even before we start playing. There we go. That's down a little bit. And I'm going to turn that one up a little bit and see where we are when we play back.
Yep.
So here we go. So the accompaniment's going to be still the same. The string's just a little bit loud. Thank you.
that's great, because using that method, you can almost fade instruments in and out, can't you, throughout the piece. So instead of the strings just cutting off, you can just ease them into the background.
It's a little detail which I try and put into my finished recordings.
Yes.
Because very often you'll see an instrumentalist won't just stop playing. He'll turn away from the microphone
or move away from it.
So the sort of volume decreases.
Yeah.
You can do all of those details.
In and you're clever enough to be doing the two at the same time.
But you could do them one at a time. That's not a problem at all.
Yeah.
And the other thing, of course, we can do is we can add more effects onto these things if we wanted to.
Yeah.
So if I wanted to put some more reverb onto that saxophone
because
it sounds a little bit dry, I can go into the different effects that we've got here and add some more echo.
Yep.
Now, that's perhaps a little bit too much, but just as an example.
Yes. Yeah.
And now I've got the option to save yet again.
Yep.
And this time I'm just saving that reverb effect on the saxophone. So this time, let's just play it back. I can fast forward, a little fast forward option. And now we've got the reverb on the saxophone.
Yep, nice. Guess what tune I'm going to be humming in there? The earworm.
But no, that's book one, by the way.
That's great. And if I can just say, having done multi-track recordings myself, the real danger is knowing when to stop. Enough is enough.
Exactly.
Because we're all guilty of thinking, I'll just add another bit to that and I'll add another bit. And in the end, if you're not careful, it just becomes a whole mess of sound. I've done it. I'm sure Andy's done it.
I'm sure
you will do it if you give it a try.
Yeah.
Sometimes less is more, isn't it?
Yes, definitely. Definitely.
But
I think that's the thing. Do give it a try at home.
Yeah, yeah.
Give it a go, because to be honest, what you can create from the sequencer is incredible.
Yeah, and if you're not sure what to do, or you're not capable of writing a part down or thinking of a part, just take a simple song like Moon River and just play it. Choose a nice instrument, play it. Then go back and think, what can I do with the strings? If you only play the root note of each chord that you're playing, so if the first chord is C, play either a C or any of the notes from a C chord, and then think it changes to A minor.
It does.
So you could either go to the A, the C, or the E, any of the notes of the A minor. And just keep it really simple, just to actually try the process.
Yes.
And the more you do it, the better you get, and actually the more adventurous you get.
And what Paul has just explained is a technique called chord notes. Now, I mention that because that's the subject of our latest book.
Well, there you go.
There you go.
There
what
you
a
go.
Coincidence.
You'd have thought I set you up for that.
You would have thought that, would you?
But yeah, we have got a whole series of books. You can check them out on the Keysound website. They're not expensive. We always say they probably cost less than the price of a cup of coffee in your local coffee shop now, but they contain a lot of valuable information, and we'll start getting the cogs whirring and thinking about your music in the right sort of way. Great, Andy. Love that.
Super. Excellent.
Another quick change of the cameras.
Okay.
And then
shall
we're
going to
give us all
piece?
A little lesson.
A quick,
yeah, that
quick
would
piece.
Be nice. I think if Andy can now just show us what the final result of a full multi-track sequence that you've actually put together.
Yes, indeed.
That would be wonderful.
I'll be back with you in just a moment.
Thank you.
Well, hello. This is my little tuition section. And all I want to talk about now is all of the different sounds and styles that you can get and how to get the best out of these sounds and styles. We were talking earlier with Paul about the good old days of the organ. And I mentioned that very, very often you could just, with your eyes closed, press a load of different buttons and get a different sound. And you'd usually put the tremolo on, which was like the old Leslie speaker, and you'd get a nice, warm, woolly organ sound. Today, on instruments like this PA1000, the sounds are so realistic that you do almost have to have a little bit more knowledge about how some of the instruments actually work. So we're going to look at, what does a trumpet do? What does a flute do? How do we get the best out of those sounds? So let's start actually with some solo voices. Solo voices, what do I mean by that? Well, if we think of an orchestra, let's look at instruments that play only one note. And that's usually what we mean by solo sounds. So oboe, clarinet, trumpet, trombone, French horn, those sort of sounds. One thing that we do forget very much to do is to let the instrumentalist breathe. Now, what I mean by that is if I play a trumpet, there was all sorts of different things going on there. But one of the things that didn't happen was actually we didn't hear the trumpeter breathe at all. Now, that's something that we need to do. So I'm going to take a little cornet here and just play a brief little phrase of a tune, perhaps a little jazz number. You'll recognise it. It goes like this. Yeah, you perhaps recognise that. In the music, there's no rest. There's no place for the player to breathe. He would be passing out by now. So we need to leave in the music just little rests every now and again, even though there may not be a rest written actually in the music, just to let the solo player actually breathe. Just take your breath in. Now, when you're first learning to play as an 8-year-old the trumpet, you need a little while to go and get your lungs full. Professional players don't need that long. They only need a very brief little break. Just that ability to let them actually suck some air in. And that applies whether it's an oboe or a flute or a clarinet, any of those single note solo instruments. Now, the other thing that's very important when the sounds are as realistic as they are now is that we actually play in the right range of the instrument sound. Now, I've got various octave controls on this instrument and I can go up really high and I can play at the top end of the keyboard and I've still got my cornet sound on here. That doesn't sound like a cornet. There is no cornet player ever in the planet that's able to play up there. If I play this, I hear it's very piercing, but it doesn't sound like a cornet. So I need to be in the right range of the keyboard, which is, now, if you don't know the range of instruments, and there's no reason really why you would, simply go to our friend Google. Google, put in what is the range of notes for a cornet, or a trumpet, or a flute, or a clarinet, and they will show you graphically and actually tell you the range of notes that you should be in. Now, to be honest, you don't have to stick absolutely rigidly to that. If you go a note extra at the top end of a cornet range, frankly, nobody is going to notice. But as long as you stay in that general range, the sounds will sound much more realistic. So that's solo instruments, instruments that play one note. But let's talk about now instruments that play more than that. And a violin, of course, only plays one note, but when you get them in an ensemble, they become much more ability to play chords, because you'll have one string player playing up there, you'll have some more string players in here, and you'll have another set of string players at the bottom, all playing different chords. So let's just put on some different string sounds here. So I'm playing chords there, and again, it's important that we're in the right range for those string sounds. But I'm using a technique called open harmony. Ooh. Here's a little tip for you. If we want to play a chord, let me play a chord of C. And I'm playing just the notes of G, C, and E. And I'm going to take the middle note out and play it an octave lower. So there's the middle note out, and let's add it down here. Now that's a much more realistic way that strings actually play. So if I go like this, this is just a C chord, but the C at the bottom, to a G chord, but I'm playing G and D with my right hand and the B with my left hand. Let's just do that again. I'm going to play F chord now, and I'm going to play A and F with my right hand and back to the C with my left hand. Then make it a minor chord, back to C. Let's just do that one more time. So here's a C open harmony, G, F, F minor. So suddenly we have a very realistic sound. The sound quality is brilliant anyway, but we're actually playing it more now like a string orchestra actually does. So that's just some very, very general tips about how to get the best out of the sounds. But let solo players breathe, play it in the right area of the keyboard, and think about sounds like strings, perhaps from a harmony, different harmony point of view. Let's now take a look at the style section, the accompaniment section. And one of the biggest areas we find where people perhaps are a little bit misguided is using the introductions that are actually available. Now, I'm just going to put on any old style here. This is, here we go. Here's a Latin jazz band. No, we won't do that. We'll do a swing band. It's not so straightforward. Now, I'm going to use intro one first here. Now, intro one on a Korg, usually, in fact, pretty much all the time, has a chord sequence built into it. So it's going to go through a different cycle of chords, and then the intro will come to an end and the basic style will start. Let's just have a listen to what happens with swing band. I've got no ideas. I sit here. So here we go. And there's the style. Okay, there's a very important point for you to remember here. We need to start to play as soon as the intro ends. How do you know when the intro ends? I can hear you cry. Well, there is a little counter in our screen which will help us. Now, let me do that once more. This is intro one, and you'll see in the screen, it will count down to zero. Let's just do that. Here we go. That's very simple. What we see lots of people do, and please don't do this, is people start to play as soon as the intro begins, which is a bit of a problem because that intro has got its own chord progression built inside. I'll play my tune and it's going to sound not very good. Let me do it. This is not going to sound good. It will go like this. Now, it may seem silly that people do that, but we do hear that quite a lot when we're out and about at different events. So, you let the intro one do its thing, and then you start to play at the end of intro one. Now, this leads us nicely to intro two. And on a Korg keyboard, intro two is a very unique little feature. Because what you can actually do with intro two is you can put in your own chord sequence. So that means I know which chords are coming up because I'm going to play them in. So here we go. This is intro two, and I'm going to do a little introduction for The Lady is a Tramp in C. And it goes like this. Here we go. Now, the real advantage of intro two, and indeed ending two is the same, is that I can play along with that because I know the chords that I'm putting in. So you can just borrow the chord notes, the notes from the chords that you're playing, play them in the right hand, and you can actually make up your own proper introduction. A little bit like this. Much more professional. So intro two, very special feature found, to my knowledge, only on Korg keyboards. Really good. So let's talk about putting all of these things together. Let's take some voices and some styles, and we're going to use just four buttons on the instrument. They're called keyboard set buttons. They're right underneath the screen of the keyboard, and these are preset sounds set up by the professional guys who design these instruments up at Korg. So let's just put on a bossa nova. Doesn't really matter. Here we go. This is just a bossa nova. Now I'm going to use these four buttons. I can see in the screen, and if you look at the screen, you can see them now. We've got a nylon guitar, an alto sax, a piano, and piano with some vocals in. So this is a bossa nova. I'm going to use intro two, so I can make up my own introduction with my own notes in it. And it goes a little bit like this. was using intro 2 and ending 2 and just the keyboard sets that are available instantly in the middle of the keyboard here. Just show you one more different style. What shall we do? Let's take a ballad style. Here's an orchestral ballad. And I can now see I've got four different presets in the keyboard sets readily available. I'm going to do intro 2 again, just because it makes it nice and simple for me. There's just a few hints and tips on how we can make great use of the fantastic voices that are in here, the stunning styles that we have, and even with Korg's help, using the keyboard set buttons, they can all come together wonderfully at the touch of a button. I hope you found this interesting. Thanks very much for watching.